Hello, I'm Simon Schama, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the face of Britain. I've been working closely with the National Portrait Gallery on this wonderful project, which has also produced a television series for the BBC, a book, and marvelous exhibition across a series of galleries at the National Portrait Gallery. The National Portrait Gallery is the best place to do this because ever since its founding in 1856, its mission has been to tell us British who we are through displays of inspirational leaders and sometimes ordinary people as well who've made a mark on national life. I've divided this project, The Face of Britain, into five parts. It's themed into the areas of interest by which I think we can look at portraits most usefully and with much enrichment. The first is called The Face of Power, and that's where a lot of the drama is concentrated because the powerful have very particular sense of how they want to be represented. Their political lives depend on it. So whether we're talking about Churchill or Margaret Thatcher, there are real drama in the tension between the sitter, the powerful, and the artist. A second theme is love. When we want to have portraits of those we love, it's often because we're going to part from them, either by death or by absence or by distance. So that is, as I hope you'll find, for example, with the portrait of John Lennon and Yoko Ono done just hours before he was shot. That's the most poignant of the categories. The third is the category of fame, the faces of fame. Portraits, pictures can make people famous. And when you go and look at the wonderful display of portraits of Sir Francis Drake, what is really important about that, he's our first famous Englishman who's not an aristocrat or a king or a prince. So the whole renown was not just about his circumnavigation of the globe or his taking on the Spanish. It was the way that Drake the face, Drake the person, was made famous by his images. The fourth is self-portraits. What is it that the artist sometimes sees when he or she look directly at the mirror? We have the magnificent portrait of Gwen John, the young woman artist, early in the 20th century, who looks with such extraordinary confidence out at herself in the mirror, in the world, and as an artist. And our last category is the category of the face of the people, where the camera goes out amongst the rest of us and tries to make images, icons, which capture something about the British people. We have, for example, the wonderful photographs of Charlie Phillips in Notting Hill and Westbourne Grove just after the terrible race riots of the end of the 50s, which I think will be a wonderful document, enchanting and moving images of what London was like and what Britain was going to become when it tried to defy hatred and prejudice. Well, I've always loved portraiture, especially historical portraits, and I'll tell you why. I was born in the last year of the war, and when I came out of it, when I started to read books, history was the only romance available. It was a very dark, austere kind of time, the late 1940s, and my dad used to walk me around every available castle that there possibly could be in Britain. But the crucial thing was to have a bond with the people we were imagining, Sir Walter Raleigh, whoever it was, the kings and queens. And the way you have a bond is not just by reading, or I like to do that, it was to have that connection, that eye-to-eye connection. We're born with that. We all need to kind of lock eyes on those who inhabit our imagination, and that's what portraits do. So I hope you enjoy the entire show in each of these galleries, in each of these categories, and come out with a sense of what portraits try and do, that you've lived for a while, for the time you've been in the gallery, in the living company of all these people.